Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. I'm still working away at the old WTF board at the moment, and this week I've decided it's about time I got my head around this one, ocean acidification. And that means yet another dose of Dangerous Dave's DIY demonstrations, so brace yourself for that coming up in a minute. Now, it's an emotive title, isn't it? Ocean acidification. Makes me think I can't go swimming in the sea without my face melting off. But is it an example of gross exaggeration to play up to the mainstream media, or is it a precise description of what's actually occurring? To be honest, I didn't have the answer to that, so I thought I'd better go and find out. Quite recently, my dad bought a soda stream, which he's very pleased with and which is certainly helping him to reduce unnecessary water and plastic waste. But it occurred to me that there's another way you can use it, so I bought my own, and here it is. Now, this thing is a can of pressurised carbon dioxide. In fact, the CO2 they use in these things is primarily a byproduct of other industrial processes. That's not to say that those processes shouldn't be moving to a carbon-free energy source, of course they should. But at least in the meantime, they've got some sort of carbon capture process, which is by no means the solution, but it's better than nothing. Oh yeah, and the irony of Pepsi, the world's second favourite sugary water producer, having just bought SodaStream, wasn't lost on me either. Anyway, these things work by forcing carbon dioxide into water at pressure, and that then dissolves in the water before bubbling up to try and escape. And that's what makes all fizzy drinks fizzy. But it also causes a chemical reaction that we can measure using one of these things, a pH indicator. And no, I didn't have a pH indicator lying around the house. And yes, I did go out and buy one just for this experiment. And yes, that is quite a nerdy thing to do. And no, I don't care, so there. Now, I've poured some water from this bottle into this jug so that we can measure the pH value. So let's have a look at it. You can just see that on the screen there. It's measuring about 7, which is bang on neutral on the pH scale. So let's get that out of there, pour it back in our bottle, and give it some CO2 and see what happens. Alright, so if we pour some of that out into here again, pop it back on here so you can see what's going on, and put our pH indicator back in. You can see that on the camera, and that comes out to 4.7, a pH of 4.7, which is very acidic. Essentially, that's what our scientists are telling us is happening in our oceans. So here's how it works. It turns out that the oceans are extremely good at absorbing CO2. Since about 1750, our industrial systems have pumped enormous quantities of CO2 into the atmosphere, and our oceans have absorbed about 30 to 40% of it. Which is just as well, because without that, our planet would be a lot warmer than it already is. Now, as the CO2 is absorbed in the oceans, this happens. Carbon dioxide plus water becomes H2CO3, which is basic chemistry that I can remember from school and which I can just about manage even now. And H2CO3 is carbonic acid. Now, this next bit gets a bit weird, so bear with me. Apparently, carbonic acid molecules can release one of their hydrogen ions to make a bicarbonate. So H2CO3 goes to HCO3 with a little minus one at the top to show that it's lost a hydrogen ion. And not content with that, the bicarbonate can then release another hydrogen ion to become a simple carbonate, which means HCO3 with a little minus one goes to CO3 with a little minus two to show that it's lost both of its hydrogen ions. I'm just saying. At normal temperature and alkalinity levels, the simple carbonate can then combine with calcium that's also in the water to make calcium carbonate. And that is what coral and shells are made of. Anyway, the surface of the oceans about 100 years ago had an average pH value of about 8.25, which is clearly on the alkaline side of neutral. But today's average pH is about 8.14. So that's a decrease of 0.11, which sounds pretty insignificant. But the pH scale is logarithmic, which means 2 isn't 1 more than 1, it's 10 times more than 1, and 3 is 10 times more than 2, which means it's 100 times more than 1. So our 0.11 reduction is actually a 30% increase in acidity, and apparently that is significant. But pH 8.14 is still well alkaline, isn't it? So why is it so important? Well, it turns out that the whole reaction we looked at earlier is reversible. It works both ways depending on temperature and alkalinity. And that means that as the CO2 concentration increases and more of the free hydrogen ions start floating around causing trouble, the simple carbonate can recombine with the hydrogen ions and go back to being a bicarbonate. The science pods have, of course, created a graph to show how things move backwards and forwards, and because scientists appear to be pathologically opposed to using simple words, it's not called a graph, it's called a Jairam plot. But I'm still going to go through it with you, so have another sip of coffee, and here we go. Right, so the vertical axis shows another logarithmic scale, this one of concentrations of carbon dioxide, bicarbonate, and simple carbonate. The horizontal axis shows the pH values ranging from very acidic over here to very alkaline over here. So when the water is very acidic, you get mostly carbonic acid, with just a little bit of bicarbonate action going on down here. And when the water reaches pH neutral, the bicarbonate combo is the dominant version of the reaction. Then as the water moves into alkaline territory, the simple carbonate end of the reaction becomes the most prevalent, which is good news for shells and corals and all of that. So if we draw a vertical line down at pH levels from around 100 years ago, and another one at today's pH level, you can start to see the direction of travel as more and more CO2 gets dissolved into the oceans. Simple carbonate levels go down and bicarbonate levels go up, and that means less carbonate available to combine with calcium to make calcium carbonate, and that means that shellfish and corals are less able to grow and repair themselves. Now, like most things that go on in our oceans and our atmosphere, the process involves loads of other variables, so it's extremely complicated and it's not black and white at all. For example, there's an argument that says that as the sea gets warmer, the metabolisms of all organisms get faster, and that includes phytoplankton. And phytoplankton take in CO2 as they grow, just like trees on the land do. So that's a good thing, right? But other studies, like this one from the American Geophysical Union, suggest that the nutrients the phytoplankton need to grow are supplied from deeper waters, and that as the oceans get warmer, you get more temperature separation between the different depths, and so there's less mixing of the layers that make these nutrients available. The thinking is that this causes phytoplankton growth and CO2 uptake to decrease, which results in more available CO2 in the water. And of course, different parts of the oceans have slightly different pH levels anyway, as these charts show, so the effects will vary around the globe. And what we really don't know is how much more CO2 human beings are going to spew out across the course of the next 50 years or so. But if we stay on what the scientists call RCP 8.5, which is the worst case representative concentration pathway, otherwise known as the business as usual scenario, which is the curve we're following at the moment, then according to the IPCC, we can expect a further lowering of average pH values of about 0.3 to 0.4 by 2100. And that'll drop the pH level down to about 7.8, which is very likely to have a negative impact on the overall ecosystem of our ocean. Here's a pteropod swimming around in water at a pH of 8.1. Pteropods are tiny little marine snails, which are really a type of plankton, but they play a very big role in the oceanic food chain and ecosystems. But here's what happens when it's put in water at a pH of 7.8, which is what we might get to in 2100 if we continue on the way we are. Now, this has been speeded up a lot. It actually took a month and a half for this to happen, but essentially the shell dissolves as the carbonate reacts with the free hydrogen ions to make bicarbonate. Although we're on the RCP 8.5 business as usual trajectory at the moment, renewable technology is advancing at breathtaking speed, and social and political will is changing fast despite the noise coming out of the White House. So it's unlikely that we'll stay on that trajectory all the way to 2100. In fact, we probably wouldn't get there if we did, if that's not an oxymoron. But a study by the Royal Society in 2014, which carried out a combined survey of the water and the pteropods along the Washington, Oregon, California coast in August 2011, showed that large portions of the shelf waters are already corrosive to the shells of these plankton. They found 53% of the onshore pteropods and 24% of offshore pteropods had what they called severe dissolution damage. The Royal Society study estimated that the incidence of severe pteropod shell dissolution owing to anthropogenic ocean acidification has doubled in nearshore habitats since pre-industrial conditions across this region and is on track to triple by 2050. So, what to make of all this complicated information? Well, ocean acidification doesn't mean that our oceans are all full of acid, so I can park my irrational fear of going swimming and melting my face. But the science is telling us that the direction of travel is towards a less alkaline composition. And when a reaction like that takes place throughout a body of water as vast and fundamental to life as our ocean system, then it must surely be something that we need to keep a very close eye on. That's it for this week. You can click on the subscribe button and the notification bell over here somewhere to get news of all the new weekly shows coming out. And do share the link if you can so we can get the word out to as many people as possible. As always, thank you very much for watching. Have a great week. And remember to just have a think. See you next week.